Here we are, back in from our little break, and we're going to resume with Public Works and Peter Rice, the Public Works Director.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good morning, councilors. As you know, the Department of Public Works is made up of four divisions: the water and sewer divisions are enterprise funds, the parking division is a special revenue fund, and the highway division is funded through the general fund revenues. This morning, we'll be speaking to the highway as well as the parking divisions. On Wednesday, staff will be speaking to the water and sewer budgets. The proposed FY18 budget is a $6.6 million budget, approximately $207,000 additional for a 3.23% increase from FY17. With the exception of additional professional services related to compliance with a new EPA stormwater permit, this proposed budget has no real major changes or initiatives. As you know, the highway division, or may know, the highway division covers a number of general areas, including facilities, roads, bridges, sidewalks, streetscape, stormwater, mosquito control, parks and fields, cemetery, solid waste collection, snow removal, assistance during special events, as well as equipment maintenance for city vehicles. As I said, the increase this year is a 3.23%. Of the total budget, the total $6.6 million, approximately 56% is related to salaries and benefits. The highway division has 55.75 full-time employees, and they're allocated in these various groups: highway, facilities, solid waste, foreman overseeing them. There's three stormwater folks, which used to be named street sweeping, but the street sweeping was associated with stormwater, and because of this new permit with EPA, we felt it was appropriate to adjust the name and call it stormwater. So that's the reflection in the a change in the budget this year. Administration, engineering, and vehicle maintenance. The highway portion of this actually is comprised of our arborist and two crew with them, the mowing crews, the street signs and striping, what was the third one on that? As well as sidewalk repairs and catch basin repairs. The areas of increase this year are really related to staffing, the salaries and retirement benefits, and other benefits. We settled a contract with our 1386 bargaining group this year, and the contract reflects that the new contract of this, which is about $177,000. The balance of the major increases really is in stormwater-related costs, and in anticipation of the permit. The new stormwater permit for the separate, it's a MS4, it's the separate storm sewer system permit, or MS4 for short. That permit was recently published by the EPA, and it'll come into effect the beginning of FY19. However, in anticipation of that, there's a lot of additional requirements in this permit. And what we are doing is we're working with the sewer division, which also allocated some monies to better define what those new requirements are so that we can see where we can absorb the additional efforts within our existing structure and try to minimize the impacts to our overall budget. Previous studies had indicated that there could be a significant increase in the department's budget as a result of this new permit, and being very cognizant of budget constraints, we're looking for creative ways to address compliance with this permit without seeing some major increases. So that's what these monies are going towards. As I said, the breakdown of this proposed increase is 85% salaries, 15% operational. Some of the initiatives that we worked on last year, or this year, this current year, include changes to the solid waste operations, road maintenance adjustments, which included things like crack sealing and means to extend the life of the pavement inventory we have throughout the city, as well as adjusting the staffing to meet changing needs, and the initiative relative to the streetlights, which I'll speak more to in a second. To aid in the decision-making process that we make and how we prioritize, we use a lot of data, and the click-and-fix system, which has been in place for the last year and a half, has been a real good asset for that. We also use our pavement condition index, as well as the sidewalk condition index, and a big part of this is resident input. So we use the data to inform our decision-making process, but it isn't the sole decider. We need to take it in the context of policies and policy decisions and when synergy can occur with other projects and those types of things. So it's more of a data-informed process versus the data driving the absolute decision. But some of the information that we've gleaned over the last year or so have helped us adjust our operations relative to the solid waste collection. Last week, we adjusted our times of collection downtown to address the ongoing challenges with garbage being left out all day prior to the nighttime pickups on Monday night. So we adjusted the hours so we have a Tuesday morning pickup for residents so they don't have to put their garbage out in the morning before they leave and have it sit out all day. So we're picking that up. And the results of last week showed pretty good compliance. We had about 80% compliance with that. We have staff that are going putting placards out and informational things for people, going door to door, talking to businesses, and trying to reinforce this change. And we anticipate, it being a slow process over the month or so before, we come into near full compliance. We also have had a lot of information relative to increased expectations relative to our green spaces. So that has aided us to shift some of our staff from areas and to augment what we have for staff addressing the greenery throughout the city, the adopter spots, the parks, and those types of things. And it also made us realize that this time of year, no matter how much staff we were able to slide from other areas, we would not be able to really get all the green spaces up and running. So we're augmenting our staff with contractual help with local landscapers to really attack some of these bigger areas. Streetlight outages were very interesting, and data that we collected through the click and fix made us realize that there were a lot more streetlights that were out, and working with the local energy provider Eversource, we were able to address all those outages, and that was a real positive result of some of the information we collected. And then this last item, snow damage reports, was an interesting thing for us. The plowing activities caused damage in a couple areas, one on private property, two on public property, and three on the equipment. And one of the things that we've noticed by looking at the data, we've seen that over time we've had younger staff don't have the background working with heavy equipment that our older guys used to. It used to be that staff would come in with, they grew up driving big trucks, they grew up handling big equipment. And nowadays, the kids are coming in with not that background or that base experience. So what we're doing is, by gathering this information, we're realizing that we need to take some of the older guys to mentor the younger guys, and doing things such as what we call snow rodeos or plowing rodeos, where we set up parking lots with cones and balls and things for them to obstacles for them to work around. And it gives them an increased sensibility relative to the equipment they're operating, and it gives them an added comfort. So, when you're out after, 5 hours, 6 hours of working with equipment, you want your base response to be, the appropriate one instead of just riding a curb, which can cause damage to a plow and can cause damage to curbs. So this, the information we've been able to collect has helped, these types of things. So operationally, we make improvements. As I said, we've adjusted our operations relative to pavement condition. In the past, we weren't doing what's called crack sealing. If you go down Market Street, you'll see there's quite a bit of this striping, black striping all over the place. We've accomplished about 29,000 road feet of crack sealing throughout the city, and that what that does is it helps reduce the aging of the pavement, and it keeps the water from getting underneath the pavement and causing heaving, and it extends the life of the pavement. As I said, our solid waste operations have been adjusted to improve the collection times, and this was started last week. And then the energy efficiencies program that we've been working with the Eversource on is replacing all our streetlights with LED lights. We're about halfway into this. We, upon completion, we'll see about or realize about $120,000 worth of savings and reduce the carbon impact by about 300 metric tons into the environment. So this is a really positive thing. And then on top of that, Eversource has granted us a $100,000 rebate, which will help with completion of this project. Areas that we're focusing on in addition to our baseline services and the work that we currently do, the additional initiatives are really focusing on this new requirement relative to stormwater. There's a lot of studies, there's a lot of additional requirements that could be out there, and obviously we don't want to wait to the last minute when the permit kicks in to come to you to say, hey, here's the ramifications of this new permit. We need to do X, Y, and Z, or we need to do this kind of infrastructure upgrade. So the next year we're really trying to spend our time gearing up to get ourselves in a position so that we can absorb this additional effort without having a major impact to our budgets. And then, you know, continue to work with staff to best optimize them and to try to, I like to say force multiply, to try to, you know, use them to augment other work we're doing in the system. The areas that I'd like to continue to augment and work with is facilities. We have, you know, 288,000 square feet of buildings that we need to maintain. A lot of them are older and need additional efforts, and so I'm trying to adjust staff to better reflect how to address those needs. This is just a breakdown of the overall budget, breaking down in the different the cost areas through the budget.
Councilor Denton.
Peter, there had been discussion prior of using organic weed control. I was looking at the budget, we have about $45,000 budgeted for weed control, and you had said that using the organic version, Avenger, is about 10 times more than what we're currently using, some equivalent of Roundup. So is it safe to say if the city was going to go forward with Avenger, it might cost 10 times the amounts instead of $45,000, maybe $450,000? Again, these numbers are up in the air, but 10 times weed control programs, about $500,000.
With that particular product, we're looking at another product. I forget the name of it, but it's a little cheaper. Currently, we use it to cut the rodeo product. So what we do is we take like a 5-to-1 ratio, and by using that citrus-based product, you're able to break down the surface of the leaf. A lot of leaves have a waxy surface. The citrus product breaks down that wax, allows the herbicide to get into the plant more effectively, so you don't have to put as much on it. So that reduces the dosage by about a fifth of what you regularly do. And so it's a good synergy between using that organic product and the more effective synthetic product. However, that we haven't tried that particular organic product by itself. So this year we want to try some pilots and to see that and I wouldn't say it would be you'd go from 47 to 470,000. There definitely would be an increase. There's additional applications that are needed, and it would be probably some more monitoring. But we haven't gone that whole route. One of the things that a topic that came up was asking us to look at the overall programs, products that we use throughout the city, and currently we have staff doing an inventory of all the products. Cleaning products and those types of things. So we hope to report back at some point in the next few months on that. But we're very conscious of trying to reduce the use of synthetic pesticides and those things. And we understand people's concerns. And there are certain types of weeds, Japanese knotweed, for example, that does not respond to organic products. It really, you have to hit it hard. It's in the rhizomes. It's in the root systems. It spreads. And unless you can get to that root, It you can't really control them. So for the short term, until they come up with a better product, some of these things are part of our arsenal or our quiver of products that we use.
Thank you.
So as I said, this is just a breakdown of the budgets. And I'm happy to say that the 8-year average is still below 2% for the highway division. So with that, I could answer some questions.
Any questions? Wow. That was really good. Thank you.
So okay.
We move along to parking.
Okay. Yeah, we could grab a chair as well. Eric Eby, if you could come on up as well. I'm sorry, I neglected to introduce Roberta Orsini, my operations manager, our operations manager. She is critical in pulling all these numbers together and does the yeoman's effort for these budgets. So I very much appreciate all the work that she does.
Welcome.
Thank you. Yeah. So to turn towards the parking the parking division as part of the Public Works Department, the Parking and Transportation Division's proposed budget of $5.2 million is approximately a $1.46 million increase, about 39% from FY17. The Parking and Transportation Division is comprised of five major cost centers: day-to-day operations and maintenance, public transportation, debt service, capital outlay, and contingency. This budget supports the existing level of service, plus additional support for operational changes, new services, and increased debt service related to the new parking garage. The operational changes include citation management software, mobile parking metering software, credit card-ready single-head meters on the streets, and additional services such as the bicycle program, which you've seen deployed just recently, support for the Chamber of Commerce in lieu of free holiday parking, as well as a percent for arts this coming year. The Parking and Transportation Division is a special revenue fund which fully is supported by parking revenues. These revenues fund the services that provide benefits to the residents, downtown businesses, and businesses.
That the budget itself is on page 381 in your budget book, so you can get more detail there if you want.
In 2012, the City Council voted to adopt the guiding parking principles for the Central Business District. These guiding principles cited that a downtown parking supply that is convenient, viable, and central to the business destinations is key to the short-term and long-term health of the city's retail, restaurants, and the city economy. This budget continues to support that policy goal. The Parking and Transportation Division is made up of around 50 employees, 17 of which are part-time, 32 full-time, 32 are part-time. The assets that we have are listed here, and we also have a program called the Easy Park Program, which is an on-dash meter that people can load money into, like a wallet, and use that instead of going to a parking meter or into a pay and display meter, and that allows us to do a 25-cent discount for residents as well. Some of the accomplishments that we have looked forward or have done for FY17 include automating the monthly pass renewal process at the Hanover Garage, upgrading our citation management, which is in process, exploring means of mobile payment to augment the Easy Park system, installing a wayfinding at the garage, which is currently in process. So the signage in the garage is going to be augmented to improve people's navigating that garage, as well as recently completed single-head credit card-ready smart meters, parking meters throughout the city. As I said, the parking transportation budget increases $1.46 million, 39%. Of the total salaries, of the total budget, salaries are 37% of that. This chart shows a breakdown of that 1.46. As you can see, there's about a 12% increase in operations, roughly an 8% in public transportation, a 41% in debt service, and that's truly related to the new parking garage. Capital outlays run about 5%, and the contingency, which I'll speak more to in a second, is around 32%. Some of the operational changes to highlight, we added one additional nighttime parking security to address our challenges with full-time parking security, to address our challenges with keeping part-timers in place. As you can imagine, having part-time staff at night is challenging people. It's hard for us to keep those positions filled, and by having an additional full-time security, we hope that we'll be able to bridge that gap better with the part-times and the full-times. One area which is unique to parking, because we're a special revenue fund, we do not benefit from the healthcare stabilization fund that the other divisions, other departments do. So this reflects a 100% increase, the full increase in the health insurance and as well as benefits. So that's reflected in that operational cost. Some of the items that increased this year as well is software, the citation management system, and what we call a data aggregation software. And this is actually an example of that data aggregation. What it does is it takes all the various data sources that we have for parking. So we have on-street meters that give us information on a real-time basis. We have the parking garage that has real-time information. We have the parking citation folks that have real-time information. And we're able to take all that stuff and put it into a dashboard, which gives us a much better feeling for what the utilization is at any particular time throughout the day. And so we can anticipate over time, and we can see when we have surges in usage, so we can better target staffing. And during special events, we can see how that the parking responds. Or if there are changes to rates and things like that, we can see the changes associated with those rate changes. So we're really looking forward to this additional information to better manage the overall operations. This is a breakdown of the overall budget. It's important to note, too, in addition to this $5.2 million as part of this, there's an additional $2.4 million that is directly distributed to the general fund, which equates to about a 50-cent reduction in the tax rate.
Just to mention a couple things, on page 391, you can see under public transportation all the things that are done that are not specific to parking. There's about $542,000 there. Many communities that are supporting Coast and other things take it out of their general fund. The downtown snow removal is at $250,000. We also have put in $150,000 for the school department for their transportation for next year, put $100,000 in for Percent for Arts, and $80,000 for the police department. So, given that, it's all probably about $1 million that, in addition to the $2.4 million that we provide to the general fund, goes to the parking fund. Comes from the parking fund to do what we would consider in some towns or cities general governments, but is related to parking.
Councilor Spear.
You mentioned the school and the Percent for Art. Oh, there they are. I was going to say they're not on that slide. So,
yeah. So this slide is about $900,000, and then this is an additional $470,000. So the city manager is correct. All told, it's close to $4 million that gets put towards the general fund as a result of parking revenues.
Could we move? There's $325,000 in the general fund snow removal. Citywide.
$250,000.
No, $325,000.
On the general fund. Correct.
Right. Could we move that also and have, why not?
Well, the more you move in, the less there's going to be for repayment of debt service and parking. The purpose of the whole idea is that we want to, when we go and start paying our debt service on our new garage, that it will come from just the rate payers. So right now we're building our reserve in that area. We already have $250,000 in this budget that goes to snow removal, and we can justify that in that snow removal is important to parking downtown and revenue sources. To try to justify in parking the additional $250,000 or something for citywide, I think you, from a policy, then what we're trying to do is we try to support things that have transportation. We have things that provide support for parking. And so all the things we've done, Coast, of course, is, a mass transportation. We have senior transportation. Those things that we can justify in this fund. And the $250,000 for snow removals, you have to remember that started at about $50,000 three, four years ago. But we can justify that because of the loadouts in the downtown, because the sooner we load out downtown, the more effective we can be in getting people to park and to pay the meters. So I would be a little cautious about putting $350,000 more in this budget, because I guess I would if you took it out of the revenue side.
Well, that's where I'm getting is I'm just trying to be creative here. It's a work session, and
then it wouldn't make any difference, because if I drop the revenue by 350 and increase this by 350,
that shift wouldn't make it. It would be a wash, right? Yeah. But I'm looking at lowering the tax rate in June, and if you do that commensurate with some other adjustment in the parking revenue side, you could reduce the tax rate.
Right, but as we get towards having to pay the debt service on the new garage, as we have to do improvements to High Hanover, I just don't want to be put into a position that all of a sudden people are saying, well, you're going to have to raise rates, or you're going to have to do something else to achieve that. I would probably more comfortable after the second garage is open to see how our cash flow is. You know, we already, you know, people, there's, I can think people have it kind of backward. We support the general fund to the point in parking to the point of about $3.4 million with all these services and then the $2.4 million in revenue. I would be very cautious about adding another $350,000 to this budget. I don't know how we would get it, to be honest with you. I don't know.
I agree with the city manager on this, and he can attest that I've been sweating bullets about, you know, making sure that we have a sustainable parking fund, so that when we take on the additional debt associated with this garage, when we do the renovations to the Hanover garage, we're going to see roughly 3 years of revenue reduction from that, you know, because we're going to take a third of the garage out of play every year. So until we take care of those things, until we have some experience relative to the new garage and revenues, I get really anxious when we start sliding things too much. We've worked very hard to make sure things are allocated to the parking revenues, such as these large blowers we use. I don't know if you've seen those before, but they're massive piece of equipment that couple hundred thousand dollars that have historically been on the highway side of the rolling stock. Those are now in parking because they're used for the downtown loadout. It's a justified cost associated with parking. Some of the sidewalk tractors are associated with downtown parking. So that things that are justified, as the city manager said, to
just
be within
this year
parking
alone,
makes sense.
We've added $300,000 in new expenditures out of there that typically, like, for example, the percent for arts was added in, the school bus support, also the Zagster. So just be careful. That's all we're saying. Yep. Be cautious on this.
So the due to the changing nature of our parking division and really the maturing of our parking program, there's been a lot of suggestions in terms of changes and things and programs that we adopt. And this contingency fund, it was really there, is here because of those changing expectations and potential desires. And there's going to be a council workshop at some point, and there may be things out of that, initiatives that come from that. So some of these monies are identified to take on those things. In addition, as you know, we're between parking directors, and so a new parking director is going to come on board, hopefully sooner than later. And it'd be the potential staffing changes may occur as a result of needs there. So I wanted to make sure there was some flexibility for that person when they came in, that they weren't completely tied, and that they had some potential options. So, and if those monies aren't spent, they will go towards the debt stabilization and revenues, so that we can, you know, cover the cost of the revenue losses from the garage and things like that.
Right. So I'm concerned about, I'm not concerned, the word contingency is, so are these in the budget, or if we pass the budget, are these
in the
allocations?
They're in the budget.
I think it's probably could have been more, I don't know, these aren't really contingencies. They're things that are in the budget. But one thing just to remember is, like, for example, the school bus support, we're going to try to reduce that every year. Mm-hmm. We'll have to talk about the percent of arts. I don't know if we can sustain that amount every year, but so it's going to have to, I haven't really talked to the council really about this. I think this came up when I was not here. But I would say that the contingencies really are the $150,000 for new parking initiatives and the $70,000 for potential staffing changes. The only other thing I would say about the snow removal, counselor, is that from time to time we get money from FEMA, and it's important that it's in an area where it's in the general fund. I want to be careful about, I don't know for a fact, but I want to just be careful that if we take it out of, you know, a parking fund, would that still keep us into that? But I think it's only, I'm really concerned about going any further.
So Eric will now speak to some of the transportation initiatives.
Okay, thank you, Peter. Mr. Mayor, City Council.
You've got to pull the microphone closer.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Hi, thank you. Good evening, good morning. Some of the projects, it's not, it hasn't been that long yet.
Oops.
Some of the projects we've been working on from the traffic side, we have several projects for traffic signals. The biggest one is going to be Woodbury Avenue up at the Newington end, Gosling Road, the seven signals along Woodbury Ave. We'll be putting in all new equipment up there. And what that'll do is help the traffic flow along that section. So if you're traveling the speed limit up there, you'll get one green light after another instead of being stuck at each red light as you proceed up the corridor. Really help that traffic up there in that commercial district. Also helping the crossings for pedestrians and bring it up to current ADA standards. Also on Maplewood Ave downtown, the four signals here shown, one at Islington, the one at State, and the two over at Deer and Hanover. We'll be upgrading the timings and phasings there to help pedestrian crossings. We added in the countdown timers last summer for the pedestrians, which really helps identify how much more time is you have to sit there waiting for the pedestrians to cross, or pedestrians how much time they have to cross. We'll be switching to a new system where pedestrians will be crossing the same time as the traffic next to them, and traffic will have to yield. It'll make things much more efficient for both traffic and pedestrians crossing the streets downtown. We've also have three or four cameras. We have a fourth camera on the way. We have traffic cameras that we use to count traffic at intersections. We use it to observe driver behavior, whether or not they're rolling through stop signs, are they yielding to pedestrians in crosswalks. It allows us to see trucks and buses and bikes and motorcycles, what the makeup of the traffic is out there. Just rather than just a simple number, it actually gets us to see how traffic operates, and it helps us make decisions on what we're doing.
So just as a point in case, this really helps us relative to citizen concerns, relative to truck traffic with construction projects, specifically the Pierce Island Treatment Plant. We receive concerns, and they say that trucks are all doing this, and you know, they're doing bad things. And so Eric, through posting these things out there and reviewing the tapes, was able to identify if trucks were doing that. And the bulk of the trucks were following the rules and doing a great job, and determined actually the majority of the problems out there were residents blazing through the stop signs and not paying attention. So that was an interesting thing. But it also helped us identify which trucks were not following the rules, and we're able to follow up and get direct feedback quickly. And it's a very good tool that Eric uses, and it's very effective, and the residents should feel good about having that tool.
Yes, and it allows us also to respond quickly to requests from citizens. Rather than having to contract out to a consultant to do these types of studies, we can collect the data ourselves, and I can review it in-house much quicker and get a response out. We also are working with Planning Department, coming up with street design guidelines. This is going to be a document that will determine preferred widths for traffic lanes and different types of streets in the neighborhoods and downtown. So when we have new projects, we can say, well, we should have a bike lane on this type of street, or we should have parking here, or we should have a green space this wide. That would be some guidelines that we'll be able to follow and point to when where we're, projects are coming in to reconstruct streets. Traffic calming guidance, we also have a program that we're working on implementing. When requests come in for crosswalks or slowing the speeds in the neighborhoods, we have some measures that we can implement, and we're going to be having a request on that. One of the first steps we do when we get the traffic calming request is we'll go out and put out a speed measurement device. Some people think, well, the people are flying through my neighborhood at 50 miles an hour. We put the recorder out there and we find out, well, they're only going 20 miles an hour. Speed is a difficult perception for an average person to really see. It's a very dependent on the width of the street and the size of the vehicles, the noise that's coming out of it. So it helps us to get data to make an informed decision on these items and whether or not to improvements are needed and what types of measures to improve. And we're also working on bicycle and pedestrian facilities. You've seen the Zagster bike share stations that have gone in just lately. We're also continuing to work on bike lane projects along Middle Street and improving pedestrian facilities, as I mentioned, the countdown timers, and looking to we're doing test pilots. The White Heron crosswalk was an example last year that was done twice. We're going to put that out again for the summer, the peak month of traffic on Islington, see how that works. And in the coordination of that, we also put the cameras out, and it lets us see, are people yielding to pedestrians? Are pedestrians having an easier time getting across? Is this causing traffic queuing, you know, a mile long? So what are the effects of these test pilots? So with these this equipment that we have, it's really been helpful. We also have seen the speed radar signs we have out there now. We've got four of those. It flashes and tells people when they're speeding. Those have been great, very effective at first. When you put them out, people are hitting the brakes and realizing they're speeding when they see those numbers flashed at them. So those are the highlights of the items we've been doing. We continue to use this equipment on a regular basis.
Councilor Spear? One
more. Ah, there we go. As I was saying, this is the example of the street.
Councilor Spear had a question.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I mean, maybe you can continue to talk about this because you still are talking about more things, but just in terms of when you're looking at the, on the previous slide, you had street design guidelines and analysis type of things. When you're doing the analysis and trying to get, and this is true with every development that comes in, look at the intersection quality and, you know, A, B, C, and then grade it based on usually on car experience in terms of, you said, like the long queuing on Islington Street and things like that for that crosswalk. Just in terms of the mission of your department, and it goes into, it permeates every decision you make in terms of the rank and the priority of, are we cars auto-centric or people-centric or bicycle-centric? And, you know, and because it's a trade-off in many cases in terms of the length of the time, how many, the crosswalks you mentioned, in terms of the signals, you know, do you do the four-way stop or the with traffic stop? And so is there a shift in thinking in terms of getting things more pedestrian, bicycle friendly in a way, and, you know, sometimes the cars will have to have longer queues?
So I'll take a quick stab at answering that. As I said in the highway portion of this presentation, the data we collect is to inform us. It's not going to necessarily drive. And one of the key components of that is other input, resident input. There's roads out there that supposedly are fine for vehicular traffic because the road is certain width, it can handle the speeds, everything's okay, it can handle, you know, thousands of cars a moment. That does not mean the societal expectation or desire is being met because that technical guideline is being met. So the data we collect is informing us in the decision. It's not making the final decision for us. So, you know, we may not be meeting the goals of safe pedestrian. We may not be meeting the goal of a residential, a quieter residential feel because for whatever reason, you know, if there's a construction project and all of a sudden everybody's taking a new detour through a community, a resident area. So we have to look at the data and use it to help inform our decision-making process. But part of that process is oftentimes is policy, too. It could be a policy decision that this is, you know, we're going to have a 20-mile-an-hour speed limit in that area because there's residents there and the residents want that, you know, that to be that slow. Well, the road as it's constructed right now is perfectly fine to handle the additional speed. Outer Islington is a great example. It's designed to handle, what, 35, 40 miles an hour. But the desire is to have it sub-30. You know, it would be 20 to 25 miles an hour. So how do you get to that point? It's, you got to have a balance and, you know, you make decisions that are informed by that data but don't necessarily, you know, preclude the other inputs. So I don't know if that – so the answer is yes, we are taking into consideration all those other things.
The other thing is I think with the – I think this is more – would be more appropriate to talk about when planning gets up there, to talk about some of the parking initiative – excuse me, the bicycle initiatives and walking initiatives that they're coming up with. And I think that would be something that you could – I think Juliet could talk about some of those things.
Yeah. And Eric works very closely with the planning department. So it's we're not siloed, separate. You know, we work very closely.
Again, this is a sample of the street design guidelines that we're working on where we can show how we would reconstruct the street. We have different standards for each type of street in the city. You know, which ones would have parking, bike lanes, travel lanes, how wide each one of these character aspects would be on each street design. Traffic calming, these are some of the measures that we have in our toolbox for using when residents in a neighborhood complain about traffic cutting through the neighborhood or going too fast. These are some of the measures that could be done. And many of them can be done on a test pilot basis. You know, a diverter like this could be done with the white plastic sticks. A mini circle can be done with some barrels or cones. Some of these things, you know, chokers and chicanes can be also done quickly, and then we can watch and see how they work before we go out and spend a lot of money on construction and making something permanent. It's a good way to do a test pilot. Any other questions? I could talk traffic all day, but I'm sure you have other things.
Councilor Sayre.
I've had a number of people asking, and maybe this is just, we'll get this answer with our a new replacement, but we have the parking app that's going on Worth Lot and Bridge Street, and you know, we're sort of transitioning over to some more modern systems, and you know, it's sort of rough timetables of what that looks like.
As soon as possible. we're currently working out the details. We're working. The program is in place for the on-street metering side of things. As you know, the Worth Lot and the Bridge Lot are there, and we could go forward with the balance of that, but we need to, it was at a pilot stage. We've been working with the software folks from, it's called Passport is the program, and we've been working with them on the citation management side of the equation, which is really the back office stuff, so that when the parking enforcement officer, you know, writes a ticket, it gets queued into the system, and then there's a certain way of going about managing that information. After 30 days, a letter gets generated. It goes to the person that got the violation. It notifies them that they're late in their fee, and then, so there's things that are tracking there. They have a certain system that's based on license plates. Our system is a ownership-based system, so we've been working with them to adjust their programming. And as a programmer, you know, you can. It's never as simple as you know. It looks great in the boardroom, but you know, sometimes the implementation takes a little while longer. We've been working out those details, and it would have been I think farther along had the previous parking director manager had not moved on to other areas, and so. I've been picking up where that is, and given the demands that I've had, I have not had the time that I would like to attend to it. And up until 2 weeks ago, we were having, you know, a couple meetings a week. So we're at a point now where we're pretty close to where we need to be, but there's some final checking, and we want to make sure the scope of deliverables is very clear, and the time frame associated with it is very clear. The intent is to have it in line before, up and running before June 30th. Of this year, so that's, you know, that's where we're at.
Go ahead.
So that's certainly very quick. The pilot must have been going pretty well. For do we have a sense of percentage of usage or how much those the Passport parking app was being used in those two lots?
I don't have those numbers right at my fingertips, but I can get that information and I'll pass it on to the city manager.
Councilor Denton.
Oh, I'm good.
Oh, okay. Thank you. As the screen says.
Oh, yeah, Beetlejuice.
So, yeah, well, we're a little bit,
Beetlejuice.
Fortunately, got a little ahead of schedule, so we're going to bring on the
Beetlejuice
recreation. Oh, yes.
Don't say it three times, John.
No, won't say it for the third time. I won't.
Beetlejuice, otherwise known as Russ Wilson, our recreation director.
These meetings every year cost me a fortune in jackets. Good morning. My budget is on page 266, 267. Recreation Department's proposed budget for this year is $870,000. This represents a 2.85 increase, mostly due to contractual and benefit obligations. We employ four full-time employees, including myself, included in this budget, along with obviously dozens of part-time and seasonal employees. We operate five facilities. We supervise hundreds of programs throughout the city, and recently, a few years ago, we took on the responsibility for both the middle and high school athletic programs. We also put out two brochures every year, winter and summer brochure. If you haven't got one, I'll leave some up on the food table to make sure you get one. The indoor pool and the senior citizen program have their own cost centers, and I'll talk about those throughout the presentation. Spinnick Point Recreation Center, we're open 7 days a week, almost 100 hours per week. 1,500 annual members, about 90% of those are residents. We started allowing non-residents in a few years ago at double the cost, but that stays pretty consistent every year. Annual budget of $265,000, and we take in revenue of about $240,000, which is obviously almost a break-even point. It shows you all the things that we run there. We run that facility, again, 100 hours a week with one full-time supervisor. The Connie Bean Center, again, open 7 days a week. This is right behind us next to the middle school, or actually attached to the middle school. It's been an excellent collaboration with the school department. It's two gyms. We own one. The school department owns the other, but it's a big open gym. The school department uses it all morning till 2:30 till they get out of school so they can have all their PE classes rather than crammed into one gym. They use two gyms now, so it's excellent for them. And from 2:30 on, by the time they get out of school, we use it all for recreation programs and athletic programs because we're running all those now anyways. What this does is the middle school gym that used to be closed some nights and weekends and holidays and things like that, now that's open. You go there any Saturday during the winter, there'll be literally over 100 kids and parents playing with their kids, playing ball, and we can lower all the baskets from 6 feet to 10 feet, so mom and dad get to come in and play with their kids every single week. Those are the other things that go on. Again, we run that facility with one full-time supervisor who also takes on the responsibility of middle school athletics. Portsmouth Indoor Pool, located up in the high school parking lot. Again, open 7 days a week, almost 100 hours per week. We started a terrific partnership with Save the Indoor Portsmouth Pool about 5 or 6 years ago. For those of you that are new to the council, about 5 to 6 years ago, we were hemorrhaging operating costs over here to the tune of $300,000 a year, probably net loss to the city. And the capital improvements were going to be over $1 million, about $1 million to $1.5 million. Organization got together and say, we'll raise money to pay for those capital costs. If the city can subsidize a certain portion of the operating costs, we work with them. We tripled actually a lot of the expenses to get in there in order to cover costs. The city subsidizes that now for $150,000. That's it. All the other cover costs are covered by admission fees, and all the capital costs are covered by SIP. To this date, improvements have exceeded $1 million. None of that was city money. All the things, new roof, new heating system, new gutters, practically, other than the concrete walls on the outside, that's basically a whole new facility right now. And they'll continue to do that. We just signed an agreement for another 5 years this past year. Pierce Island Outdoor Pool. Operating budget of about $169,000, operating for 9 weeks during the summer. We give free lessons to all the Portsmouth residents, which is a great opportunity. I hope we never get rid of that for the kids that can't afford to take lessons at the indoor pool. The water starts at about a foot deep, which is great to give lessons to the kids up to 6 feet deep. And any given day, especially on a hot day, we'll have 1,000 to 1,400 people over the course of the day at the indoor pool. That's staffed with all part-time people.
Yes, if I might, Ross, just on the with the operations of the for the construction of the wastewater treatment plant, I sent you a copy of a press release that we're sending out. We're going to be starting work on the parking lot over near the Fort Tree Island, and we hope to augment about another 25 spaces to that. And so we're trying to fast track it, and just let you know that's going to start probably very soon, and we're going to try to get that parking lot open before Russ's program starts so that we can have, you know, at least probably about 45 spaces, 50 spaces over there.
Right. Pierce Island Boat Launch, we staff that Memorial Day through Labor Day, just on weekends, Monday through Friday. We don't get enough boats to make it worthwhile, but there'll be an average of 25 trailers per day on the weekend. Again, free for residents. The person there is mostly to keep a lot of non-residents from using this, keep it free for residents, all the parking space in the launch, but we do allow limited non-residents in, anywhere from a kayak, $10, up to a full boat for $20 fee. Our summer recreation programs, we run a day camp for 500 elementary children for the 9 weeks, 60 kids per week. All kinds of other camps and programs going on during the summer. Again, staffed with all part-time staff, mostly college kids, supervised by our full-time staff. We have all kinds of special events, fireworks. This year we're partnering with the Wilcox industry. They've donated, I think you all know, $40,000 to make that a really fantastic event. So it'll be special entertainment for that, as well as enhanced fireworks, the Easter egg hunt, holiday parades, road races, special events. We work with all the different leagues in the city that have their own board of directors. We schedule all the open space in the city. And any other special events that go on in the city, we have some hand in it somehow. Our senior citizen program that has a special cost center is right after the recreation department in your budget book. That's been open for a few years now. It has a $158,000 operating budget, 900 members. That breaks down to about a 60-40 resident to non-resident ratio, 60% resident, 40% non-resident from the surrounding area, Kittery, Rye, Greenland, Newcastle. Drop-in center, monthly luncheons, annual cookouts, flu shots, everything that you want for seniors. And obviously, we're working on establishing a new senior center at the Doble Center. I'll give you a little heads up where that stands now. The Army Reserve is taking their last steps and turning it over to the Army Corps of Engineers. And once they do that, they'll transfer that property to the city. We expect that to happen in the next 3 to 6 months, maybe. We all know how the federal government works, so we're keeping our fingers crossed. We've resolved all the concerns relative to the historic restrictions on Doble. We're pretty much able to keep the shell like it is, but move the insides so we can establish it as a senior center and recreation center that we want. In the meantime, we're working and moving ahead with the architectural firm to lay out the inside and make sure that's all ready to go when we get that property. Again, we do all the athletics at Portsmouth Middle School and Portsmouth High School. It's been a lot of fun. The school is absolutely amazing to work with. We have a great relationship with them for a lot of things that we do, and that's worked out extremely well, having both the recreation and athletics all under one roof. That's all I have. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Councilor Spear.
That hand went up awful quick.
It did.
My head.
It did. And, well, is the school, is the, sorry, the pool money, $150,000, is that separate from your budget?
Yes. John, and the $150,000 is located.
It's in the
separate line,
budget, and
right?
It's on a separate line.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, if you look at your summary portion of budget.
So your 285 is just for the non-pool. And what's your budget is?
No, the actual operating budget for the indoor pool is about $414,000.
Right. Oh, that's a better point, Rick.
What is the general fund?
Your total, your 870 is your total. 870.
Yes.
Is your total.
So that's everything except senior citizen and indoor pool. Yes.
One thing I've brought up in the past, and I want to ask it again. Have we considered making this the Parks and Rec department so we can?
We're talking about that internally. So. Okay. It would be a change in our administrative code.
And it might be some change in the funding, too, depending on, you know.
Depending. I don't know. I think, again, we're talking about that. There's models out there we'd like to take a look at because we do have property that is passive recreation that I don't think Russ really gets involved with, but we can look at that.
All right.
But it would take an administrative code change, which is just really an ordinance change.
Okay. And then one more question, Your Honor.
Yes.
The I know that we're very excited with the field purchase by the community campus, a lot of potential there. And that was part of the report we did a few years ago looking at trying to get a unified field, right? And one of the other things it mentioned was unified indoor recreation space.
Mm-hmm.
So we're not long-term, has your department thought about, I know we got Spinnaker, and now we're doing the Doble thing, which is kind of these separate.
Absolutely.
You know, and the indoor pool is another third one.
Absolutely.
Separate, not as good as having. So at least can there be a roadmap for the next 5 or 10 years that says, okay, we're going to have a serious indoor community recreation.
Absolutely. Center. That's been our goal all along. In the meantime, we're just piecemealing as we go just to keep all the activities fresh. But our long-term goal is to have, if not everything under one roof, as much as we can get under one roof.
I guess if we can have it somewhere either in the CIP or somewhere that says, you know, we're really going toward this.
Again, this is going to be a policy decision of the council. One thing that the Recreation Board was looking at as part of its inquiry on the Doble with the senior center or whatever we're going to call it, over 55, whatever, they also were looking at doing, and going into the future, phasing in a total community center over there. It hasn't, I think at this point, until we get the Doble officially in our possession, we'll then have, there's room to actually, from some layouts that were done, right, Russ?
Yes.
That shows additional space for gymnasiums and adult, to take the place of Spinnaker at some point. Spinnaker is a building that is tired. And
that was my main concern, that we don't start spending money on Spinnaker.
Now we're trying to be very careful over there, but sometimes you have to spend money on humidification, things of that sort. So, yeah, we're looking at that, and I think the recreation board is looking at the same thing.
Correct.
Councilor Sear?
It seems like, for the most part, all of the programs, and there's a kind of an incredible amount. It's outstanding for the city. It's really kind of geared for kids for people 5 and up, right? Are there other rec departments or in other cities that are that have programs that are actually even younger than that? The reason why I bring it up is, you know, there's I think a fair amount of studies now that show how impactful programs are at that pre-K level. Not to suggest that we should do pre-K, although that'd be an interesting conversation for another time. But are there other models we could look at for the future?
Absolutely. And when we had space, meaning when we had the community center, which was a 4-story building with not only a gym, but we had 4 floors of rooms other than that, and now we just have basically 2 gyms that we work out of all our youth programs. We had all kinds of classes for kids under 5, exercise classes and, you know, anything else we could think of for kids under 5. If and when, for instance, we get Doble's and we have more room to do that, and we'd certainly be able to reinstitute that. Because, yes, we want to have programs from birth to 100 years old, and other programs do it, and we would love to do it.
Great. And we get
calls all the time. You wouldn't believe. I have a 2-year-old. We wonder if you have a baseball league for them. Well, you know, can they walk yet? You know, I mean,
you got to start them young.
So yeah, we'd be happy to do that.
Great. Well, thank you. Okay.
Thank you, guys.
And I always enjoy your outfits.
Thank you.
So we're a little bit ahead of schedule, but we're going to move right into planning, inspection, health with Nancy Culbert-Puff.
Thank you, Mayor. It's a pleasure to be here before the City Council today, my second year. I'm here to present the planning, inspections, and health budgets to you. Together, we're about 16 people. And let's move on to slide number 1. You can see our pictures here.
Notice there's a picture missing.
Saying I don't do selfies, so that's the one that's missing there. But, you know, we do have 6 staff planners, including the planning director, and 3 support staff that work in the department. I think that what you heard this morning was, to my knowledge, unplanned and extraordinary in terms of you're hearing the other departments and how closely they're working with planning and how planning. Good planning in the city is really a combination of working with DPW, police, and fire to really notice how the city is changing and where people are living in the city and how that impacts the organization as a whole. So I was delighted to see the police chief presenting the master plan as part of his department. Some of the highlights for this year, we have a new planning director, Juliette Walker, who is here, and will be answering questions later, I'm sure. We will be adding 2 new staff planners. We've added 1 already. So his first week, Peter Stith, is now with us. And in order to replace Juliette, we will be hiring a principal planner as well this year. This year is going to be a big year in terms of we've adopted the master plan now and we'll be implementing that. So some of the things that the council will be seeing in short order involve the housing committee zoning recommendations. They are coming up very, very immediately before the council. As a result of having a new master plan, we'll be doing a comprehensive zoning update as part of that to begin very shortly. You heard during the CIP presentations that we'll be working on an open space plan this year to include all of the passive recreation areas that have maybe not gotten a complete planning look in recent years. And you also have heard many presentations about all of the major projects that are going on in the city. And, you know, I just noting a few of them that the city manager has mentioned over 350,000 square feet is going to be developed in the Deer Street area alongside our garage. We have the Vaughn Bridge Worth Lot planning that we're about to start working on with chairing by Councillor Rebecca Perkins. And sorry, I was pausing there for a second. And at its next meeting, actually, the council will review a request for qualifications for the redevelopment of the McIntyre site. Some of the performance measures that we show regularly as part of the budget presentation have to do with how many land use applications are before all of the boards. Those remain fairly consistent, although last year reflected a 50% increase, and now we're headed for a slight decrease. They stay fairly constant. It's a very, very busy department. And this year, we thought we'd give you also a look at some of the projects that the department has been doing over the course of the last 3 years. So these are projects that have been started and completed or continue to be active, including the North End Vision Plan and the character-based zoning. That was such a major effort. The West End Vision Plan and the character-based zoning that was adopted pursuant to that. of course, the master plan, the wayfinding program that you have already seen, phase one completed, phase two and phase three are to come. So you can hear more about that from Juliet if you have any questions about wayfinding. The Middle Street bicycle route and the complete street program that's going to be in place for Middle Street is active right now. We have the New Hampshire Seacoast Greenway, or the rail trail that we talk about, all the coordination that's going on throughout the state of New Hampshire and reaching back into Massachusetts as well. The Housing Committee report recommendation, and we're always doing pedestrian and bicycle planning, so Juliet can talk about bicycle boulevard design. In summary, the planning department budget really hasn't changed too much this year. Salary and benefits and associated costs with personnel are pretty much the only change to the budget. We've added another $1,000 to accommodate additional training for our new staff for a total increase of 4.37%, and the budget is $819,000. Moving forward again, we'll be implementing the master plan. You can see here that this is a 3D modeling of the proposed development that's happening in the Deer Street neighborhood. This is a look at the 299 Vaughan Street.
Real quick question.
Yep.
I keep seeing those four buildings popping up in front of the parking garage.
Yeah.
What are they?
Are you pointing to these right here?
Yes, those four.
Those are existing.
Oh, all right.
So they're kind of colored white, but they're existing buildings, yeah. And we're beginning the design process for Maplewood Avenue Complete Street. I'll go on to before I go on.
Yes. Three questions. In your list of objectives, one of the things that I've been waiting for is the kind of this phase two omnibus zoning revisions. Is that? And it's not in the active, started, or completed phase. So where are we on that?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, so the zoning is also something that we have on our list to do as part of the implementation of the master plan. So the zoning land use regulations update. We're going to be starting kicking that off on early next fiscal year, so July probably.
Early next?
Fiscal year, so this coming July.
This coming July.
Yes, we have plans already. We have a scope of work already crafted out, and we're going to be working on doing a full zoning sort of omnibus idea as part of that process.
Covering which items again?
Things that are related to implementation of the master plan.
Of this current master plan?
Yes.
No, I'm talking about there were things on the back burner for...
Right. Other zoning issues that we've sort of put on hold, that'll be integrated into this as well.
Integrated into that as
well. Yeah, yeah. And we haven't decided whether that would come, we have to work on whether that would come as one omnibus or whether we'd come in
because some of those are
pieces
from the previous master plan of 10 years ago. Just...
Well, some of them are. Some of them, we've made good progress on some of them, though.
Yes.
I mean, some of the things from the last master plan we've already implemented. So things that we're looking about that have carried over from previous discussions are improving our parking, requirements, because we have to be more responsive to current situations versus, a set, per square footage type of thing. It's more of a collaborative effort on that
maybe
one.
Maybe what we can do an update that we can do is just to get, once we have the scope of services, maybe review the scope.
Okay. And then... looking at that slide that had all of the, we've seen this before recently, all the new construction happening in the Deer Street garage in the north tier area, it got me thinking, and this has come up in the past, but I want to raise it as something, it's so different when a resident is going to ask for, they want to put a porch on or a new window, and they got to go to HGC, and you're on the HGC, I'm interested to hear your opinion. That's one ask, that's one process, and I've been on the committee too, and then we'll look at, the detailing on their railing or something on that particular, and they'll spend half an hour, 45 minutes on it, on that one thing, right?
True story.
And then you've got these, $60, $80 million worth of projects happening. So my question is, from a policy standpoint, is that something that maybe we should have two committees, One committee does kind of residential, and it very and they're and that's what they do. They get good at it, and those citizen volunteers are, you know, still historic district, but they're focused on that type of problem, and a different skill set would apply to these monster projects that are commercial in use, and those citizen volunteers are kind of geared toward that. And you're dealing with different, you're dealing with lawyers and engineers and all kinds of different people on that aspect. So your feedback.
Yeah, so I don't know if Councilor Pearson wants to chime in on this, but we have implemented a process where we have administrative approval by staff. So then that sort of captures some of those smaller residential projects. We did, yeah, Nancy's just pointing to our tracking of that. Last year, we started implementing this in fiscal year 16, and we did about 100 administrative approvals. That means that basically our principal planner, Nick Cracknell, puts forward his recommendation to the HDC, and it's basically like a, you know, they can vote individually or can just do a consent agenda, and they usually defer to him on those. Occasionally they'll pull it off and consider it separately. And then this year we went up, we did almost 125 administrative approvals. So we are trying to respond to that difference in scale and complexity of projects by doing it that way. You know, we could continue to evaluate that. If that goes up significantly, we may have to think about a different process.
One other thing that's helped is the design guidelines that have been created, and I think that Nick actually just reminded the commission in an email since our last meeting on Wednesday, but I think it's a habit that the commission needs to get into more regularly, but deferring to those design guidelines for applicants, and it is really different dealing with an applicant who may or may not have an architect, who may or may not even understand or have full plans versus, you know, an army of architects and lawyers coming to the table. And it does take different communication skills, but I think that I'm told that it's more efficient than it used to be. I think it works pretty well. We spend an hour talking about windows in our first applicant on Wednesday. That still happens. It just does.
Moving right along.
I have one more question.
As long as it's about the budget.
Yeah. I was asking about this during transportation, and then I was told let's ask about it during planning.
Sure.
So here we are.
Okay.
Well, so my question is, you know, when you're dealing with these types of decisions, you have to make policy decisions internally, and maybe the council can guide you. But in terms of, you know, are we auto-centric or people-centric in terms of how you design roads, buildings, all these things. So,
do you want me to respond to that? So planning department takes a lead, but we work like very like a partnership. Really, it's not really one department taking a lead, but we sort of track our progress in relation to the complete streets policy, our bike and walk friendly policy. So, it's under our responsibility to report back to City Council, how are we doing on this, and what kind of metrics are we using, or what are we doing in our development reviews to further those policies. So we are, again, the Planning Department is working on this land use regulation update, and one of the things we'll be thinking about is what are we doing in our regulations to encourage focusing on bicycle and pedestrians friendly measures versus just being car-centric. That's one thing we can absolutely control. The other area that planning gets involved is on projects that we take a project management lead on, like the Maplewood Ave Downtown Complete Street project, which we're about to start, and the Middle Street Bike Lane project. And those are implementations of the bike and ped master plan.
Okay. Moving along to inspections, we have five staff in the inspections department that you see all here. I have their pictures now because we've gone to the online permitting system that we're finding to be very effective and particularly interesting with regard to being able to analyze quickly what types of permits are coming in, where the permits are in terms of their approvals. If you had visited the inspections department before we went to online permitting in the morning, you would have seen a line of people out the door waiting to fill in their permits and get help from the staff. That has tremendously been reduced, actually. So a lot of our interaction now is much more quick. You get quick responses via email from the inspectors themselves, and the inspectors continue to have more time, actually, in the mornings when they have regular office hours to interact with people who have particular questions.
Councilor Perkins?
Have you gotten feedback from some of our customers to your department about how this new system's working?
I've gotten feedback, mostly all positive. There are some people that continue to come in who are particularly unfamiliar with using computers. You know, some of the tradespeople are uncomfortable with that. But we do have a station set up in the department, and we will help anybody who comes in through every step of the process. So I think, I'm glad you asked that question. It's there are some people that continue to be intimidated by the idea that it's online now instead of, you know, filling it in at the desk outside in the hallway. But they simply need to come in and just ask, how would I go about that? And we do have people physically go and help them fill in an online application. And once you create an account and you are online, it becomes much easier from that point. So as soon as you kind of get introduced to the system once, I think that people are finding it easy to use. And they could, we get applications in now essentially 24/7. So you can be, you know, Saturday afternoon, you know, on your couch and fill in a building permit application that will be submitted at that time. So,
great.
And again, we'll be talking more at the retreat on June 3rd about the updates that we'd like to make to our local ordinance with regard to building code. But we've been working closely with the fire department and the health department, which I'll talk about in a second, to make sure that our codes are all up to date and people understand what the rules are in terms of building in Portsmouth. The budget this year, you'll see really just a fairly, well, first I'll talk about performance measures, I guess. The total permits for this year look to be on par with last year. There's been very little slowdown as far as the building department goes. So we are on track again to see about $100 million of declared construction value. The city manager mentioned that that doesn't all hit at the same time. So April 1st is the assessing deadline for which new growth happens. But in terms of tracking, you know, what does it look like into the future, the permittings, the permit construction values really haven't slowed down in the last year. So that's good news. The permit fees will be over $1 million the building department expects to process. And this year, the budget request reflects essentially funding for backup inspectors, so such that if somebody goes on vacation, we're able to fill that position and get the inspections done in a timely manner. So we've funded enough money to fill in for vacationing inspectors. Moving forward, again, you'll see you'll learn more about the differences in code versions at the June 3rd retreat. And this is just another look at our online permitting site. I'll move on to the health department if there are no questions. We essentially have two full-time health department professionals plus one part-time. And the health department mission really is to promote and protect and enhance the health and well-being of Portsmouth residents, visitors, and the environment. This is Kim McNamara, our health officer, and Kristen Shaw, our deputy health officer, and Tony McClellan, our health inspector, part-time. The health department, in addition to inspecting the over 27,000 restaurant seats available to the general public in excess of the census, actually participates actively in the community assistance panel put on by the ATSDR. Is participating in the Restoration Advisory Board at Pease, also participates in the Governor's Task Force on the Seacoast Cancer Cluster, continues to be involved in supporting the Safe Harbor Recovery Center that's recently opened. It weighs in on you know, emerging contaminants and climate change and community planning and emergency response. Kim is very active in working with all departments, including the fire department, on what would happen during times of emergency and a regional sheltering plan. One of the things that she thinks about a lot is as the city accommodates additional hotel rooms and tourist facilities, how we would respond to that in terms of emergency. And here you have just the health permits every year, again, 27,000 plus seats in restaurants, an average of 25 to 30 temporary events per year. So on June 3rd, when we talk about the code changes, one of the things I'm keeping in mind is that Chowderfest is that day. So Kim will be out inspecting Chowderfest amid coming to the council's retreat. And the budget here really just reflects basic, you know, personnel costs increased. So moving forward, the health department has also gone to an online system of inspections. Right now, they're using it pretty much internally, where they can go and inspect a restaurant and immediately give feedback to the restaurant owner as to how they're doing with regard to complying with health code. And they're able to print out an evaluation that includes a score for the restaurant to tell them, you know, pretty quickly how they're doing on all of these criteria that are part of the food code.
Councilor Sear, then Councilor Spear.
So for this report and the score, that's something that's available to the public?
It is. It is public information available on request.
Upon request.
Yes.
One of the things we're going to look at as we talk in the retreat is the idea of continuing the scoring, but maybe create a, if you've seen in other cities, A, B, and C at the front door, something like that. So that'll be a policy decision. So, you know, 90 to 100 would be an A, et cetera. I assume they'd mostly all be A's at that point.
And Councilor Spear.
And another way to, if there, I don't, like Yelp, people often look at Yelp, and then if there was a stream of data that could go from here to Yelp, and so, you know, Yelp has, you know, stars for this, dollars for that, and also the score for the health department. So right when you're looking at which restaurants you want to go to, yeah, they taste good, but look, they got a, you know, 75 on the score, I'm not going there. So that type of, really, that's to me, that's a better transparency than, you know, stupid process transparencies, but actual output transparencies that the government can really help people make decisions on, I think that is really, would be really, so is there a way that we can, have that?
Well, I think that what we should do is, I think you should think about that a little bit more, and on June 3rd we should talk about that, because it has really a lot of policy implications. I think we should, you know, make sure that whatever we put out there is consistent, and so that's why we'll look at a couple of these methods. I mean, I think you have to let people know, and I'm sure if somebody knew, let's say, for example, we were going to start rating people A, B, or C after, you know, a certain period of time, after Kim does her inspections and they come up to speed on that, then are they going to get an A or B or a C? If they know that's going to be posted, I think there'd be more of an incentive to get to that A. So I think we need to let, you know, the restaurants, I think the restaurants, and Kim's done a great job of doing some best practices, especially with some of the specialty type restaurants that may have a different culture associated with them. And so she does trainings and things of that sort in addition. So, yeah. It's a big part of our department now.
Yeah, especially with that many licensed seats. Has it gone up significantly? I noticed we were at last year, I think it was, I've been using the figure of 23,000. I see it's 27. Yeah. And I, when people ask me things about Portsmouth that aren't from Portsmouth, that's a statistic that sort of spells out what a vibrant city this is, that everyone wants to be here, not everybody can live here. But, so thank you.
Okay, thank you. The next item is lunch, I guess.
Yeah, why don't we break for lunch since we're close to the 11:45 and
okay, Kimmy, can
yeah, perfect. We're a little bit of